This work, we explore the possibility to identify cluster members in galaxy clusters, combining an extensive spectroscopy measurement together with HST multiband imaging. So, as I said, the main goal of this work is identification of cluster members in galaxy cluster directly from HST images, adopting a deep learning approach based on the implementation of a convolutional neural network. In this work, we also explored model capabilities and limits together with the comparison with other photometric-based approaches. In order to train our convolutional network, we need to build a knowledge space, which is a dataset composed by thousands of images in which each image, each source, has a label. In order to label this image, we use a combination of ClashBRT, VMOS, and Muse observations. So I start my presentation with an introduction about the cluster member identification problem, a brief description about the data and the methodology we adopted in order to solve the problem. Then I discuss with you about the performed experiments and the comparison with other techniques. Finally, I will show you a very fast and simple application of our model. So, cluster members are elliptical galaxies strongly bounded by gravity, forming massive systems composed by hundreds of galaxies. Such cluster acts as unique laboratory where study galaxy formation and evolution once they have been disentangled from the background and foreground object, as the image I'm showing you, in which all the background and foreground object have been masked, resulting into the galaxy population. Furthermore, the simultaneous identification of cluster members and strong gravitational lens events allowed to estimate the total mass distribution of the cluster, and once the baryonic counterpart have been independently measured, allowed the study of dark matter distribution. Finally, by studying the cluster substructure, it's possible to constrain cosmological parameters. Traditionally, cluster member identification is performed through a combination of spectroscopy and photometry. The simplest approach consists into the identification in a color magnitude diagram of the red sequence using a set of spectroscopic members. Other approaches prefer to estimate photometric redshift or through a Bayesian regression or through an application of machine learning, for example, using a multi-layer perceptron. Another approach that has been used in order to identify a cluster member is a Bayesian classifier, which makes prediction in a multidimensional color space. Now, apart from the performances of these methods, all these techniques require accurate photometric measurements in order to solve the problem. Such measurements are particularly difficult in galaxy clusters due to the contamination from the BCG, the bright cluster galaxy, and the intracluster light. Now, the question is, how can we train a neural network in order to identify cluster members using image and spectroscopy? That means avoiding any kind of photometric measurements. So this is a depict of of the 15 involved clusters. They're spanning a redshift range between 0.2 and 0.6, part of clash and frontier field surveys. In order to build the ecology space, we use an extensive spectroscopy measurement based on ClashBRT, VMOS, and Muse observations, resulting into about 3,800 objects. And in order to label these sources, in order to split between a cluster member and non-cluster member, we're using a threshold on the velocity separation. We assume as cluster member a source with the velocity separation, a rest frame velocity separation within 3,000 km per second, resulting into about 1,800 spectroscopic members. You can see their redshift distribution in the figure in the upper right corner, and in the tab there is the specific about all the involved amount of samples. Indeed, in first place, we want to analyze the trade-off between the increasing of the involved bands and the simultaneous reduction of the available number of samples. In fact,
Isabella, sorry if I disturb you. So probably you can hide, there is the message of the Google Meet below in the screen, the Google message.
I
You
can
can
hear
hide
that.
it.
Yes.
Yeah. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. Indeed, there are different sizes between the near infrared field of view and the optical ones. In particular, the near infrared field of views are smaller than the optical ones. This means that since we have to take the intersection, enlarging the set of the involved band, we observe a reduction of the available number of samples. Based on these considerations, we chosen for four different band configuration: ACS, which involves all the seven optical bands, all which involves all the 12 available bands, optical five opti seven optical plus five in the near infrared. Then we chosen from for the front field filters, three in the optical plus two in the near infrared. And since two clusters, which are Hubble 370 and Hubble 2744, are available only in the front field configurations, we split between mixed and mixed star, where the last one involves the two front field clusters. Now, as I said, our chronology space is composed by thousands of images that have been extracted from the spectroscopic catalog, extracted a squared cutout centered on the source position and with a size of about 4 arcseconds, corresponding to 64 pixels. This is a random extraction of cluster members belonging to four different clusters. 10 cluster members for each cluster, represented in five bands, the front field filters. And as I said in the introduction, we opted for a deep learning approach since we are interested to classify objects directly from the images. This is a peculiar properties of deep learning methods that are able during the training phase to develop filters in order to solve the problems. In particular, our model was inspired by the BGGNet, which is a widely used network in order to classify objects in images. We modify just a little the literature configuration, for example, increasing the number of layers. Our configuration is a concatenation of 47 layers among convolutional and pooling layers. We opted for a Lucky ReLU as activation function. We prefer AdaDelta as optimizer instead of the classical stochastic gradient descendant in order to minimize the loss functions, which is simply a negative log likelihood. We are implementing an early stopping regularization criteria and a gradual reduction of the release rate during the training phase. Our implementation is based on Keras, exploiting TensorFlow as backend. TensorFlow is a Python open source library which allows a transparent use of the graphic processor unit. Now, the main problem of this work is the limited amount of available samples in order to build the train and the test set. So, in order to circumvent this problem, we combine a classical data augmentation technique with a k-fold approach. The data augmentation process consists into a transformation of original images through rotation and flip. This is an example of this process in the figure in the upper right corner, in which the original image, which is the first column represented into the five front field bands, that has been rotated and flipped, rotated by three times by 90 degrees and vertically and horizontally flipped. Now, in order to avoid the introduction of too many correlations within the train set, we constrain the data augmentation to the 50% of the of the involved resources. In this slide, there is also showed the K-fold, the pipeline, if you want, of our work, starting from the cohomology space. In this figure, the K-fold is represented with the K-value of 4, but actually in our work we use a K-value equal to 10. So, which is the idea? Starting from the cohomology space, we apply first validation splitting, then we apply the K-fold splitting. Each fold is augmented, then iteratively taking K minus one folds as training set and leaving the last one, the K, as test set, we can evaluate the performances fold by fold and globally by stacking the K test folds, which is why use a K-fold. It increases the statistical significance of the test set. We performed a blind test only on original images, and with the K-fold approach, we guarantee a complete coverage for both the train and the test set, keeping them well separated. In order to measure the performances of our network, we used several statistical estimators that can be deduced from a binary confusion matrix, as the one shown in the upper left corner. Typically, estimators are the average efficiency, sometimes it's called accuracy, and it's related to the mean performances. Purity, which is sometimes called as precision, and it's related to the degree of contamination. Completeness, sometimes it's called as recall, and it's related to the capability to identify all the sources. Now, average efficiency refers to all the involved classes, while purity and completeness are referred to each involved class. Now, there is a well-known trade-off between purity and completeness. Intuitively, if I want a higher degree of purity, that means a lower degree of contamination, I cannot take all the sources. On contrary, if I want to take all the sources, then, well, I have to assume a higher degree of contamination. So in order to take in account this trade-off, we use also the F1 score, which is the harmonic mean between purity and completeness. Another widely used statistical estimator is the ROC curve. ROC curve is a diagram where the true positive rate, if you want the completeness, is plotted against the false positive rate, that means one minus purity, or if you prefer, the probability of a false alarm. The network, the model, overall performances can be evaluated by the area under the curve, where an area of 1 implying a perfect classification, while an area of 0.5 implying a randomly predictions like a launch of a coin. Now, in this first experiment, we combine all the available clusters by stacking their sources. The main idea behind this experiment is that even if cluster members at different depth, at different redshift, so moving from a cluster to another, exhibit several different photometric and morphological features, the network, the convolutional network, knowing its unique label during the train, could be able to find a way to separate this object, disentangling from background and foreground object. In this work, we also explored the trade-off, as already introduced, between the increasing of the involved bands and the simultaneous reduction of the available number of samples. In the histogram is show the performances archived by convolutional network for the four chosen configuration, and you can see how the mixed star configuration reaches the best result with the best trade-off between purity and completeness. Also, if we dive into the performances evaluated individually for each cluster, we found that the optimal performances are covered in 50% of cases by the mixed star combination. And even when this is not the optimal configuration, the difference between the best ones are constrained within 2-3%. Another aspect that we have investigated in this first experiment is the dependence on the redshift. In order to explore this aspect, we split the cluster member redshift range into five equal size bin and then evaluate the performance in each bin, always with the k-fold approach. And you can see from the figure in the upper, in the bottom right corner, there is not a dependence on redshift since all the estimators are more or less comparable with each other. Another aspect we have investigated in this first experiment is dependence of the amount of samples. In order to achieve this, we iteratively increase the available number of samples, always with a k-fold approach. And you can see from these four diagrams, we observe a saturation of both performances and their fluctuations seen as their variances for a number of available samples in the train set larger than 1,500. So, in this first experiment, we were interested to combine all the clusters that were available. But due to the k-fold approach that we have used, each cluster has been split in a train and in a test set. So, what about if we remove a cluster from the training distribution? In order to explore this aspect, we removed from the training distribution Abel 370, which is the optimal choice since it is more or less in the center of the redshift distribution, and it has enough sources in order to give a good statistical significance to the test set. So, always with the aim to explore the trade-off between the redshift range and the amount of training samples, we define three different training configurations, narrow, intermediate, and large. Starting from Abel 370, we increase the number of the involved clusters. Then, we also included up two further test clusters, MO329 and MS2137, which are respectively outside at the edge, outside the three training configuration that we have chosen. On the right, you can see the performances evaluated independently for the three test clusters by stacking them on the last row and for the three configuration sets. And you can see, moving from left to right, you can observe a mean increase of performances together with a reducing of their fluctuation. But in this second experiment, we also want to explore a dependence on magnitude and on color. So we split among the sources of the three test clusters, the sources between brighter and fainter, rendered and bluer. And then you can see there is a significant gap between these two classes. The gap between brighter and fainter can be predictable since fainter objects have a less informative contribution, while the difference between redder and bluer could be due to the similarity between the bluer cluster members and the non-cluster members. We come back about this problem later because maybe it's the most interesting part of our work. In the experiment, we compare our network with two photometric-based approach. In particular, we chose as benchmark methods a Bayesian classifier, which make prediction in a multi-dimensional color space that has already been used to identify cluster members in these four clusters, R2248, MO416, M126, and M1149. So we restrict the analysis on these four clusters, and we also compare our convolutional network with the Random Forest, which is a widely used machine learning tool consisting into a collection of decision trees trained on a parameter space composed by magnitudes and colors. So you can see in the left figure a comparison between these two techniques in terms of rock cubes, and there is a significant gap between the convolutional network and the Bayesian classifier. But from the rock cubes, it seems that convolutional network and random forest are not so different. So if we dive into the performances evaluated in terms of the introduced statistical estimator, we find an interesting and significant gap also between convolutional network and random forest. Convolutional network show a gain in terms of performances between 2 and 10%, reaching a remarkable result of overall performances just below the 90%. So, what about the remaining 10%? What about the misclassified sources performed by convolutional network? This is just a random extraction of true positive, false negative, and false positive of one cluster, M12-6. I remember that true positive are cluster member, correctly classified as cluster member. False positive are non-cluster member, incorrectly classified as cluster member. False negatives are cluster members, incorrectly classified as non-cluster members. So false positive and false negative represent the misclassified prediction performed by a convolutional network. Even if this is just a subsampling of, or a small subsampling of the overall distribution, we can deduce some information that can guide us in the next part of the talk. It seems that false positive are typically redder, while false negative are bluer. But in this image, there is also another information that we can deduce is the coding. How a contaminators, how other sources in the cutout can affect CNN capabilities to predict membership. In order to answer this question, we introduce a contamination index for each cutout, which is defined as the sum on the contaminators of in the cutout of 1 divided by the distance between the contaminator and the center of image multiplied by its magnitude. Indices for cutout without contamination sources have been set to 0, then we normalize these indices between 0 and 1. As you can see from the distribution in terms of contamination index for classes, true positive, true negative, false positive, and false negatives, these classes follow more or less the same trend. And this suggests that there isn't a correlation between the misclassified prediction and the contamination index. That's interesting, since the lack of a correlation suggests that the convolutional network during the training phase have developed filters able to focus its attention on the center of the image, neglecting any contaminators that could be present in the cutout. So maybe the most interesting part is the analysis of dependence on color and magnitude. So in these three figures show the distribution of magnitude on color and a color magnitude diagram. Now you can see how false positive typically populate the red region. 35% are on red sequence. That means 1 sigma. That means that they are distance are within 1 sigma from the median of the members. And so their misclassification are due to the similarity between in terms of color between this object and cluster members. Concerning the false negatives, they typically populate the bluer and the fainter regions of the parameter space. And as you can see from the color magnitude diagram, they also sparsely sampling the bluer region of the parameter space. So if we simply remove such bluer and fainter object from the test set, we find an increasing in terms of purity completeness of about 2 and 6%, a small reduction of about 6% in terms of false positives, and a remarkable reduction of false negatives of about 44%. So Finally, I will show a very simple and fast application of our model, the searching of new cluster members in the field of view of four clusters. This is the usage of a trained convolutional network in order to find, in order to classify sources that have not been before classified, is a process typically known in the machine learning context as a RAN process. So, in order to build the RAN set, we extracted thumbnails centered on the source position with a side of 4x second, as done for the chronology space. The resulting RAN set consists into about 5,000 objects, and you can see in this image the distribution. In all this image, in green, there are the spectroscopic members that are the sources that we have used to training the convolutional network, while in magenta, there are the RAN members. That means the new candidate members identified by convolutional network. And you can see how can we complete the galaxy population with this application. So, in conclusion, we have shown how it's possible to identify cluster members directly from images, exploiting a convolutional network. That means avoiding any kind of photometric measurement. We have also show how convolutional network can easier reaches a purity completeness rate of about 90% over a wide range. We also show how it's possible to maximize convolutional network performances combining both optical and infrared information with the larger set of samples. Finally, with the comparison with other techniques, we show that convolutional network identified cluster members with the lowest rate of contamination and the best trade-off between purity and completeness. Concerning the future work, maybe the first simple extension of this work is the application of a RAN process to the 39 clusters of RELIX HST data, which are in the same redshift. The same study redshift range. Another simple extension is the application on ground-based wide field multicolor data, for example, Subaru, DLT, or of course LST, but also with Euclid MOX data. I am also interested to explore other advanced deep learning techniques. For example, the usage of region convolutional network in order to identify objects in galaxy cluster without any cutout extraction, but also a problem that we have not the time to focus on, which is the problem of missing data due to the different sizes of the field of views. Maybe we can use some deep learning techniques, for example, deep autoencoder or generative adversarial network in order to impute such missing data information. So thank you for your attention and for your time.